Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for this message of truth, for the message of grace, because you are love. The message of measuring up because of your Son. The message of eternal life because you love us. In Jesus' name we pray. Galatians 5:22 we just read, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things there is no law. This is the third in our series on discipleship. Discipleship has to do with discipline, does it not? Yes, it does. Every disciple who engages in a discipline looks toward something as an outcome. That's called the product. What is the product of discipline? For the musician who is the violinist, after he or she gets through that scratchy period, it is beautiful, beautiful music. It's like the angels singing. It's absolutely beautiful. The musician has mastered the violin. The disciple of Christ practices his or her craft as well, until he or she has been mastered. Did you hear that? Not until we have mastered what it is to be like Christ, but until we have been mastered by Christ. Then we have become the disciples that he's called us to be. This is the process of discipleship. The more empty of self we become, the more we become the substance from which growth can occur. And the growth that he calls us to is to bear fruit. Now, some of you I've heard directly or through the grapevine that some of you are kind of tired of these acrostics. We've got two more. We have this week, and we have next week. And starting the third week from now, the second weekend in October, we're going to be doing expository preaching, which is a little bit different than what you've been experiencing, but it will be preaching directly from the Word of God. So, to bear fruit, we need to be the light of Christ. Be the light of Christ. Now, Matthew 5:14-16 states, "You are the light of the world. A city on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand, and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before men, that they may see your good deeds and praise your Father who is in heaven." Now, we're more often interested in shining our own lights. Now, that's what we're taught, right? We're taught to shine. More often than not, we believe we need to be shining more than someone else. In fact, we compare our light to others. We say, "Oh, my light's brighter. Oh, I'm not quite as bright. I'm a little dim when it comes to that one." But we compare one to the other. And that's not what God is calling us to do. And yet, how many of us in this world have built a life around trying to shine brighter and brighter and brighter on our own? When we state here that discipleship calls us to be the light of Christ, it means dying to self that his light might shine. Dying to self that his light might shine. As we decrease, he increases. Now let's listen further for some clues as to how we might allow his light to shine more brightly in us, to the world. That's what he calls us to do. Let's look at Galatians 5, 22 through 23, and this is to express his gentleness. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things there is no law. Now, true gentleness is an outward expression of a love-filled heart. True gentleness is an outward expression of a love-filled heart. It's no mistake that Paul began his contrasting statement about the fruit of the Spirit here with love being first. In those of you who have been around since June, where did we start in the messages about building the foundation of where we're going as this body of Christ? In love. In love. From that love that is of God, that is agape love, flows a stream of characteristics that are manifestations of agape itself. Since gentleness is a product of agape through the working of the Holy Spirit, it's not something we can contrive. Gentleness is not something that we can take on ourselves. Often, gentleness, how we express gentleness, is as a means of control. I'll be meek and I'll be mild and no one will bother me. Or a way of trying to influence someone else. Or a way of trying to manipulate the behaviors of others or get the favor of others. His gentleness, however, is the real thing. His gentleness is the real thing. It's grounded in the security of who he is, firmly planted in the knowledge of who is in control, that is God, without need for pretense. True gentleness expresses a meekness that shows an inheritance where? In the kingdom of God. True gentleness shows an inheritance in the kingdom of God. For the disciple, it cannot be contrived. It's only for those who have died to self. The self that squelches the Spirit. The self that crowds him out. In the words of a dear brother, those of you who were around a few years ago to hear this sermon, are you dead yet? Have you died to self yet? To allow his gentleness to be the master of you? The gentleness of Christ was possible only by his obedience to the will of the Father. Gentleness then opens our hearts to learning, quiets our minds to listening, and brightens our eyes to see others and ourselves as the Master sees us. To see others and ourselves as the Master sees us. Now, how do we get there? Certainly not by my design, not by your design, but by his design. And the first way of getting there is to accept his call. To accept his call. Let's see. The phone is ringing. The phone is ringing. As Pastor Les would say, it's very serious. It's very serious.
Yes, God.
Yes. You want me to follow you? Okay. Yeah. I'm not my own. I have been bought. I've been bought with a price. Silly, isn't it? But we talk with God as though He's making a phone call to us, as though we are God and can decide whether we're going to follow Him or not. You see, we already belong to Him. He has already purchased us. He paid a price that we couldn't pay if we lived a million, trillion, quadrillion years. Now, that's a long time. That's not as long as eternity, but that's a long time. He paid a price for our lives. Do you know the price that we pay for our lives? It's death. He paid a price, His death on the cross, that overcame the death that we are deserving. And He paid that price so that we could have life and have it abundantly and have it eternally. He says, follow me. His call to follow is not so that we can measure up, folks, but because He has already done what's necessary for us to be measured up. Therefore, we can walk as the new person that He's made us to be. When I am aware and secure in who I am and that I'm loved, I act differently than I do when I'm trying to win your favor. Remember relationships when they first start? Trying to influence each other? Trying to win the favor of the other? Once we are secure in who we are in the Lord, we don't have to try to win His favor. We already have His favor. We can work and work and be discipled and follow Him because we already have His favor. He calls us to discipleship so that through His love we might experience, what is it? Joy, peace, and that we might express patience and kindness and goodness and faithfulness and gentleness and self-control. And what are those things called? The fruit of the Spirit. Imagine, if you will, if all of us as human beings recognize the uniqueness of what God has already done in our lives, and we died enough to selves, that God was living in us and we were experiencing the fruit of the Spirit, these things that we've just described, imagine how many people in the legal system would be put out of work because there would be no need. There would be no need. Against such things, there is no law. Against such things, there is no law. Before the universe was created, Scripture tells us that He had us in mind. We were created for a purpose. And it's only by following Him that that purpose for our lives is realized, folks. 2 years ago this October, we began a series of sermons that was the beginning of our worship time here at the GLCC. And the sermons and the Bible studies we called The Purpose-Driven Life. He is why we were created. We were created to fellowship, to honor, to worship, and to serve Him. True happiness and fulfillment can only be achieved within the context of that knowledge. When we are called to accept Him for who He is, our Lord, our Savior, and we humble ourselves and confess our created nature, that we are not God, that we were created by Him, we begin the process of discipleship that grounds us in a place to reach out in love to others. To reach out in love to others. The great commandment, to love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, and soul, and likewise to love your neighbor as yourself. Now let's go to the 13th chapter of Corinthians. You can follow along up here because it's going to be different in your version. I'm using the Message version, the translation there. And I'm going to read, just listen carefully, what he says about reaching out in love to others. If I speak with human eloquence and angelic ecstasy, but don't love, I'm nothing but the creaking of a rusty gate. If I speak God's word with power, revealing all his mysteries and making everything plain as day, and if I have faith that says to a mountain, jump, and it jumps, but I don't love, I'm nothing. If I give everything I own to the poor and even go to the stake to be burned as a martyr, but I don't love, I've gotten nowhere. So no matter what I say, what I believe, and what I do, I'm bankrupt without love. Love never gives up. Love cares more for others than for self. Love doesn't want what it doesn't have. Love doesn't strut. Love doesn't have a swelled head. Doesn't force itself on others. Isn't always me first. Doesn't fly off the handle. Doesn't keep score of the sins of others. Doesn't revel when others grovel. Takes pleasure in the flowering of truth. Puts up with anything. Trusts God always. Always looks for the best. Never looks back, but keeps going to the end. Love never dies. Inspired speech will be over someday. Praying in tongues will end. Understanding will reach its limit. We know only a portion of the truth. And what we say about God is always incomplete. But when the complete arrives, our incompletes will be canceled. When I was an infant at my mother's breast, I gurgled and cooed like an infant, but I grew up. I left those infant ways for good. We don't yet see things clearly. We're squinting in a fog, peering through a mist, but it won't be long before the weather clears and the sun shines bright. We'll see it all then, see it all as clearly as God sees us, knowing him directly, just as he knows us. But for right now, until that completeness, we have three things to do to lead us toward that consummation. Trust steadily in God, hope unswervingly, love extravagantly. And the best of the three is love. With love then as our foundation in fellowship and discipleship, it's time to formulate your service plan. Formulate your service plan. Proverbs 19:21 states, "Many are the plans in a man's heart, but it is the Lord's purpose that prevails." Now this wisdom literature reminds us that the plans we make need to be grounded in the new heart that we've received from God. The plans that we make amount to that new theological term we learned, diddly squat. But the plans that we make because of his leading in our lives make all the difference in the world. Without a plan to tackle this thing we call discipleship, we set ourselves up for frustration and disappointment. Now, some of you may say, well, I don't set a plan. I just wait on the Lord. And I see where he's going to lead me. Well, folks, that's your plan. That's your plan. And then you haven't identified, and if you haven't identified what waiting on the Lord looks like, you're probably setting yourself up for disappointment because You already have a specific outcome in mind. We lie to ourselves over and over again. I have no expectations. Yes, we do. We have expectations. James tells us that faith without works is dead. Many of us have bought the lie that salvation is based on how well we behave. That's not true. Our salvation is secure in Christ. Therefore, we behave in a way that reflects the character that we've been given. There are times when we are called to wait on Him, but more often than not, He calls us to action on His behalf. You have a purpose. Formulate your plan for service out of what you know to be His purpose in your life. You and I have only one shot at this life of service here. There's only one shot at it. What's your plan? What's your plan for service and discipleship? You say, I don't know. I don't know how to do it. Well, of course you do. You can learn. Part of it, part of our not having a plan for how we're going to be discipled is out of ignorance. Most of the time, ignorance is not terminal. Ignorance is curable. And if you want to know more about how to develop your service plan and your plan of discipleship, there are three paid pastors on staff here, and there are several elders, and there are numerous deacons and trustees with whom you can confer, who will help you define what that plan is about. But let's talk a little bit more about how to go about doing that. One of the best ways is to remove the impediments. Remove the impediments. In our class 301, Discovering Your Ministry, we ask the question, everybody ready for this? If you knew you couldn't fail, what would you do with your life? If you knew you couldn't fail, what would you do with your life? This is where the heart for service lies. It's part of how and why He created you. So I suggest that you think about that question long and hard. If you couldn't fail, what is it that you would do? Now, think about it from this perspective. You have a heart to do that, not for your benefit alone. It is for your benefit, but it is for the benefit of others, and it is for the benefit of God. And He has given you that heart to be able to do that and to define what that is. And more importantly, if you've got the God who has given it to you, the God who has measured you up, the God who is in control of all things behind you, what is your fear of failing? What is the fear of failing? Some may say, well, it's financial. I don't have the finances to be able to do it. Or I'm fearful. Or I don't have the skill. I don't have the knowledge. Whatever it is, it's only an impediment. It's not a barrier. Do you know the difference between an impediment and a barrier? Okay, I'm going to tell you. I want to be on the outside of this building. That wall is a barrier. Is it not? I can't, in this body, I can't walk through walls. Now, if I want to get to the outside, I have to figure out how I go about doing that. Right now, the position that I'm in and the position that I want to be is impeded by something. It's impeded by which direction I should go, where are the openings, and thirdly, by my ability to be able to move from here to there. Once I determine that I am able, which he has created you to be able to do this, then I look at what is the opening, what is the opportunity for me to move there, and then I take the route. I have then overcome the impediment for me being to where I want to be. Everybody with me? Okay. So an impediment is something that we can overcome. And I submit to you that the greatest impediments that we experience are not external. The greatest impediments to serving Him and discipleship are not external. They are our own rebellion, our fears, and our doubts. They are our impediments, and they can be overcome. How do we get rid of those impediments? Here's another acrostic, folks. Act. Get over those impediments by acting. And that means acknowledging that they exist, communicating to God your desire to change, and trusting Him to answer that prayer. Act. Acknowledge. This is what we do when we accept Christ as our Savior. We acknowledge where we are and our sinfulness. We communicate to God our desire to have that taken away. The prayer that we have just prayed. Surrender to Him and living in the knowledge of who we are because of who He is demonstrates His gift of faith for the journey that He's called us on. And then we are called to utilize His gifts. Matthew chapter 25 records a parable by Jesus of three servants who were given talents or sums of money by their master. The master went away for a time, and when he returned, he called the three together for an accounting of how they had used the money that they had been given. The first one returned. There was one who had been given five talents, one who had been given two talents, and one who had been given one talent. The fellow who had been given the five talents came back with 10. It's 100% return on his investment. He had come back with 10. And Jesus said, or the master said, "Well done, good and faithful servant. You've been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Come now and share in your master's happiness." The fellow with the two talents came back with 4. He also had doubled what he had been given. And the master said the same thing to him. "Well done, my good and faithful servant. You have been faithful in a few things. You will be given more things. Come and share in your master's happiness." The third fellow came back. He had been given one talent, and he came back with one talent. And the master said, "What is this? You come back with the same thing you were given. The others have multiplied it. You've done nothing with it. Now, give me that talent." And he gave it to the one who had 10. And he said, "Now, go and live with yourself," in essence. God gives us gifts to use, to multiply, to expand, for His glory. And when we do that, what happens? We enjoy the happiness of the Master. We join in the happiness of the Master. What are the gifts that He gives us? Those gifts, He tells us, are joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faith, gentleness, self-control. And this is the product that's working in all of us, to His very glory. And then we are to ignite His passion within. Ignite His passion within. You know, at some point in time, we've all been passionate about something, have we not? Anybody here never been passionate? Okay, I was just wondering. We've been passionate in our lives. We've been passionate about sinning. We've been passionate about seeking what we want for ourselves. We've been passionate about our false ego needs. His passion, on the other hand, is founded in love. When we ignite His passion within ourselves, we can expect an eagerness to look out for the best interest of others. An eagerness to look out for the best interest of others. To begin to see them as Christ sees them. To see ourselves in the light of Christ's loving reflection. You see, we are the reflection of Christ to God because of what Christ has done, not because of what we have done. As we love more deeply, we begin to see that reflection. So, what is it that ignites this love? What is going to ignite the passion from within? Faith. Faith. Faith that His promises hold true, that He is who He says He is, that the fruit we bear is in direct proportion to our submission to His will in service to His cause. Want to experience the flame of passion again in your life? Do you? Want to experience it for the first time in your life? Take the steps of faith to act on His promise that He came into the world to save the world and to bring light into this place. Those steps of faith are action, action that serves, action that loves, action that demonstrates the gift of faith given to each of us. And each of us, folks, is given a measure of faith. That is a gift, and that gift is to be multiplied by exercising it. Igniting His passion within gives a return on that investment that is 100%. You can't find a better deal. It takes commitment, however, to follow through. It takes commitment to follow through. For the opportunity we share in His happiness, when we commit, then we can give Him thanks or thank Him for the bounty. Now, what's the bounty that we get? Is it money? Is it the latest fashion? Is it good looks? Is it our brain? Our capacity? No. We're thankful in all things, but the bounty that is ours through Him is the fruit of the Spirit. We experience as a result of our surrender to His leading in our lives. You see, all the other stuff that we seek after and we chase after is all going to go away. What is eternal? The fruit of the Spirit that He gives us. The task of the Christian is not to become so righteous as to show ourselves acceptable to Him, but rather to become so dead to self that His righteousness overflows in our lives and manifests itself in love to one another. It doesn't matter who we are. It doesn't matter where we've been, how smart we are, how limited, how rich, how poor, or how religious we are. All that matters is our faith expressing itself through love. That's from Galatians 5, 6b. The only thing that counts, the only thing that counts is faith expressing itself through love. Give thanks for the bounty of love you've been given by putting your faith into action for the good of others. What does that look like in your service plan? Shall we pray? Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for the opportunity to empty these shells that we've tried to make so important. We thank you, Lord, for the love that is so great that you would sacrifice your own Son so that all the things that we've tried to do to measure up are not important. All the ways in which we fall short, all the ways in which we constantly mess it up, aren't important. They're gone. And what has taken its place is the love and the bounty of your Son. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for love, joy, peace, goodness, kindness, gentleness, mercy, self-control that is ours because of your Son, Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen.